I'm Malcolm Chalmers. I'm the Deputy Director General here at RUSI. And I think we've got a really interesting session ahead of us. Just to remind you that we are conducting this under RUSI rules, which means that presentations are on the record, but all the Q&A thereafter is off the record. What I find particularly fascinating about this session is, first of all, I'm not at all sure what people are going to say, so that's always a good start for keeping the old grey cells working. But second of all, the title of the session, isn't this a remarkable title? Do European states still have principles when it comes to China? Well, first of all, I suppose it begs the question that at some stage it implies that European states did have principles, which no doubt our speakers will address that question. But I think it's also ask yourselves how many parts of the world you would ask this question. Would you say, does Russia have principles when it comes to China? Does Indonesia have principles when it comes to China? Does Japan have principles coming to China? What do we mean by principles in this question? And implicitly, I think, in the question, and again, I hope our speakers will address this, is there's a difference between principles and interests. That there's something about the European approach to dealing with China, and I think to dealing with foreign policy more generally, which isn't simply about a calculation of interests, whether they're economic or security, but is about a values-based, a norm-based approach to international relations, which is, of course, a broader debate, which is very much, on one level, above and beyond the focus today. But I think it is relevant. Many of the most important, difficult debates on European foreign policy over the last 20 years, I would say, is about the balance between values and interests, indeed whether such a distinction can be made. And I think it's fair to say we are at a moment, perhaps particularly in the United States, but also I think to some extent in this country, where there has been more of a shift towards emphasizing interests and more skepticism about values, because values-based military interventions in particular have been seen by many as being not entirely satisfactory in their outcomes. So that's part of the broader background on the security side. But I think it's also perhaps a debate about whether interests can be best pursued collectively through international institutions and norms, whether it's the UN or the International Law of the Sea or whatever it might be. And that it's a false dichotomy between values and interests. It may be more about individual state interests or the collective interests of the global community. So those initial remarks by me are designed only to problematize the essay question you were given as to whether European states, singly or collectively, have ever had principles, and what do we mean by principles? In relation to, is this simply an economics versus security debate? I mean, I know often in my experience, debates about the EU or Europe vis-a-vis China are more about whether the EU should put its economic interests first or should give more attention to geopolitics and security, which of course is an interest versus interest question. But it may be that it's more appropriate to think about the extent to which the European Union or individual European states have principles that go beyond the specific interests, even collective interests, which we have. So without further ado, let me just introduce our first speaker, Marianne Péron-Doise. I don't know whether you've spoken already today, but really delighted for you to be joining us here in London. We have a range of European perspectives on this particular issue, and I'll be very interested to hear what you have to say. Marianne, please. And the presentations are being filmed.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for your warm words. And as you may understand, I will try to elaborate a French perspective on the on this topic. I know it is not very easy to be the first panelist at the beginning of the afternoon after the lunch, but I will do my best to keep you awake. So, well, globally speaking, from a EU perspective or for a French perspective, you may know that relations with China are very important, but of course very complex and very difficult. It has been already mentioned this morning that EU is China's largest trading partner, while China is EU's second largest trading partner after the US. And despite this flourishing exchange, there are issues regarding fundamental values, such as the arms embargo. We didn't mention this topic till this morning. The question of Tibet, Taiwan, human rights, and these issues continue to be very conflictual. After the Tiananmen Square repression, you may remember that the Europeans imposed an arms embargo. And this issue is still very divisive within the EU. While some member states were in favor of a lift, the European Parliament voted against it, keeping the embargo in place. On the Tibet issue, for example, you may remember that in 2008, China refused to participate in a regular EU-China summit just to protest after a meeting with Dalai Lama by the French president, Nicolas Sarkozy. And it was at a time where France were holding the rotating presidency of the EU. And you know that Tibet remained and meeting with the Dalai Lama remain a very sensitive issue. And there have been also very frequent confrontation around concern of China dumping textile, solar panels, and more recently steel products. And a very polemical issue concerning the market economy status of China came up for decision by the EU Commission in mid-December. China insists that it is no longer a state trading country, and again, the European Parliament has taken an opposite view. Of course, China is likely to get its market economy status, but the EU will also agree on stronger measures against this unfair competition. The EU-China last summit took place in Beijing in July last year. And it was, as you remember, maybe preceded with several ministerial meetings and dialogue between officials on subjects ranging from energy, social security, education, research, and indeed human rights. And the possibility of EU cooperation with the One Belt and One Road regional infrastructure plan was under active consideration. On its side, China is contributing to the Juncker program for investment job in and growth in Europe, whereas the EU supported the Chinese initiative for the ASEAN Infrastructure Investment Bank at a time when the US was pushing for a boycott. A week before the summit, the EU set out a very ambitious agenda to continue the deepening of relations with China. And in fact, and I quote Federica Mogherini, our High Representative for Foreign Policy, the European Union and China already cooperate on so much. We work together on the global and political issue of our time, such as Iran, Syria, Afghanistan, migration, and climate change. But the issue of the South China Sea came with arbitration and complicated a little this idyllic landscape. In March 2016, pushed by France, United Kingdom and Germany, the High Representative have issued a declaration on, I quote, recent development in the South China Sea, expressing concern about deployment of missiles on island in the South China Sea and underlining the ASEAN-led process on the code of conduct, as the best way to solve the question by dialogue and cooperation. In June the same year, the EU Commission and the EU External Services produced a joint document for a new European strategy on China, proposed that cooperation between Brussels and Washington in the South China Sea was, I quote, reinforced. But once again, EU appeared divided on how handle the matter, as it emerged in the wake of the award rendered by the Arbitration Tribunal of La Hague. The EU communique acknowledged the arbitration, but also mentioned the importance, I quote, of upholding the freedom, rights and duties established by UNCLOS. But in a statement issued a day after the High Representative communique, the President of the European Council, Mr. Donald Tusk, speaking at the ASEM, Asia European meeting, mentioned briefly the South China Sea alongside with Ukraine, alongside with North Korea, and in a very generic way, the need to protect a rule-based order. And it appears that NATO itself appeared to be divided on the subject, and it is quite understandable that facing crisis in Ukraine and the Middle East, NATO doesn't look to be in a position to challenge China in East Asia. Regarding the Western Pacific region, in the final communique after the Warsaw Summit in July last year, NATO leader only expressed a global concern about the nuclear threat coming from North Korea, but no mention at all of the South China Sea problem. And this persistent division within the EU also exists, of course, within the Association of Southeast Asian Nations, whose country member did not have a common stance on the South China Sea award. On its side, France, an EU nation with an Asian-Pacific military projection, has expressed an interest in leading EU South China Sea patrol to sustain freedom of navigation in the region. After the ruling, the French ambassador to the Philippines said Paris could play a brokering role to ease tension between Beijing and Manila. Britain and Germany, which lobby for a clear reference to the South China Sea ruling in the final statement of the ASEAN meeting, as opposed to other European and ASEAN participants, are quite supporting the French initiative. And this is not easy in the current economic and political context in EU. In the aftermath of Brexit, Britain is moving to exit from the EU, and China is an economic and political partner not to be neglected. As for Germany, its economy is really very interconnected with that of China, and it is quite doubtful that Berlin want to operate as far as to East Asia, given that it has always been quite reluctant to join an EU military mission in Europe neighborhood, like the Middle East and like North Africa. And thus, in light of growing Sino-European economic ties and Europe's attitude to work at most as a facilitator in possible negotiation between Beijing and the other South China Sea claimants, it is probable that a credible and operational Euro-Atlantic cooperation in the disputed water of East Asia will not be easy to materialize, at least in military terms. For now, France show a real willingness to play an active role and to join ASEAN goodwill partner to defend a rule-based order at sea in the Asia-Pacific. And this was at the heart of exchange between President Hollande and the Prime Minister Abe from Japan during his visit to Paris yesterday. France military cooperation and security activities in the Asia-Pacific are often unknown, if underestimated. But the fact is France is a neighboring country in Asia-Pacific and has developed growing close ties with several countries in the area. And this Asia-Pacific identity of France is clearly mentioned in the White Paper on National Defense and Security published in 2008 and 2013, which acknowledge a French interest in the region. And the Defense Ministry elaborate a very specific document also explaining French policy in the region. And it is not hard to see what is behind French interest in the Asian Pacific. Our permanent ambassador for the Pacific usually speaks of France, I quote, maritimity. And it's true that France has a number of French overseas territories with various status in the region. Along with France's other possession in the Western Atlantic, they give France the second largest maritime domain in the world. France has stationed, among other assets, in the Indian Ocean, in the southern of Indian Ocean, 1,900 personnel and 5 ships. In New Caledonia, France has 1,800 personnel and 4 ships. In the French Polynesia, France has deployed 1,000 personnel and 3 ships. And its current, if current French claims are upheld for the extension of its sovereign right over continental shelves based on the implementation of the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, France's maritime domain would become the world's largest. And of course, France is already part of a quadrilateral defense coordination group, the Quad, along with United States, Australia, and New Zealand, which seeks to coordinate maritime security cooperation in Asia-Pacific. France is also a member of the France-Australia-New Zealand Agreement to coordinate regional relief operation, notably after cyclone and other natural disaster. Of course, it may be quite exaggerated to see that France, following the US move, is pivoting to Asia, as its strategic focus will continue to be on Europe, to be on Middle East and Africa. And in fact, France didn't discover Asia or pivot or rebalance because France is a neighboring country. And France has also inherited 2 collective defense commitments from the Cold War, one for the defense of South Korea and another less well known but still legally in existence as a party to the Southeast Asia Collective Defense Pact of 1954. And finally, like China, like Russia, United States and United Kingdom, France's twin status as a permanent member of the UN Security Council and party to the Nuclear Proliferation Treaty ties it to the region, and in particular regarding the development of the North Korea nuclear and ballistic program. And since the 2000s, France has taken a quite positive stance to Western-minded Asia-Pacific countries and tried to diversify its security relationship in the region. And in 2006, it became the first European country to sign the Treaty of Amity and Cooperation in Southeast Asia, a peace treaty struck by the founding members of ASEAN. Maritime security issues, including piracy and drug trafficking, are at the forefront of France's bilateral cooperation in the region. Paris supports the uniform implementation of UNCLOS and is keen not only to protect its territorial water, for instance, its fish-rich areas, but also to assert the right of innocent passage, notably in the increasingly tense South China Sea. In a speech to the June 2016 Shangri-La Dialogue held in Singapore, the French Defense Minister Jean-Yves Le Drian, who has attended this annual dialogue every year since he came into office, made clear in his speech that France will be, I quote, sailing its ship and flying its planes wherever international law will allow and wherever operational needs request that we do so. And Le Drian also invited European nations to undertake, I quote, regular and visible patrol in this area. And of course, Paris would like the European Union to coordinate such patrol in order at least to symbolically ensure a constant European presence in the disputed water. And of course, France is truly aware of its military and operational limitation in the region, we do not have the capability of very rapid deploy large force beyond the Strait of Malacca. And even with the recent defense deal we signed with different countries in the region, France will never be a dominant military player in the Asia-Pacific. But it would be equally an error to believe that France's current security priority in Europe detracted from nurturing its other interests around the world. Just to conclude, where are we now? The current French government is a strong supporter of free trade, and following the speech of Chinese President Xi at Davos and its call on Europe and China to fight against protectionism, this is apparently a strong willingness to develop closer ties with China in Europe and France. And Donald Trump's recent move on the TTP is also offering another opportunity for Europe and France to become greater partner of China. Another interesting perspective is offered through the Chinese One Belt, One Road initiative. Of course, one may object that China is in a very dominant position and could take advantage of a divided Europe, because Beijing knows the attractive power of China's investment for European countries in search for fresh money and investor. And the fact is that Europe is not actually in a strong position. It is taken by political turmoil, illustrated by the rise of Euro-skepticism, protectionism, and populism. In the Pacific, for France, there is an awaited evolution of the French territory of New Caledonia. In 2 years, a self-determination referendum will be held. And New Caledonia, economically, you know, is largely dependent on nickel mining and is progressively shifting from Australia to the Chinese market. Regarding the South China Sea dispute, France's expected new president will have to decide whether or not the French Navy will continue to patrol the disputed area in order to enforce freedom of navigation, and as it has been decided by the current defense minister. But for now, I want to say that a naval group with a Mistral amphibious ship and a Lafayette frigate are transiting to the Pacific right now. And this naval group, with two helicopters from the Royal Navy and 60 Royal Marines on board, will proceed to the China Sea. And the group will make a port visit to Singapore, to Guam, Australia, and Japan. And also an amphibious exercise will be held with US and Japanese assets around Guam. And I think that, and this will be my conclusion, this is more than symbolic. And I'm really happy to finish my presentation with this example of a Franco-British strategic connivance.
Great, thank you very much indeed. Marianne, thank you very much indeed for getting us started. A very wide-ranging and insightful presentation, I thought, reflecting, I think, both your academic background, but your extensive experience also in the French Ministry of Defense and indeed in NATO. And you covered both the wider European approach, but also, I think, a specifically French dimension, which sometimes we don't always pay enough attention to. France has always, for a very long time at least, been a Pacific power. It's never left the region, and I think you reflected the importance of that dimension when thinking about European attitudes towards the region more generally. Thank you very much. For our second speaker, we have Veerle Nouwens, who's a research analyst here at RUSI, we're delighted to say, but she's also worked for the European External Action Service in Singapore in a previous guise, so has a regional perspective there too. So Veerle, over to you.
Thank you, Malcolm, and thank you, Marianne, for a very comprehensive overview. So I think I can skip some of the facts that I had in my speech. Looking at this question, I did wonder what we were talking about when we spoke of European states and how they interact, especially within the EU framework. in the Asia Pacific, but also what we mean when we talked about principles, and Malcolm has rightly identified that this is ultimately also a discussion about norms and values. But what came to mind for me immediately, specifically also regarding my interest in Chinese foreign policy, was of course its economic engagement in Europe and what this means for European member states and the European Union and their policy in the Asia Pacific. It is an obvious and wide-ranging debate currently that Chinese investment in Europe is in preventing European countries, as well as the EU as a whole, from responding effectively to Chinese domestic and foreign policy concerns through economic leverage. But does China have economic leverage over Europe? China has, its economy has recently eclipsed, as we all know, that of the European Union as the world's second largest economy. Its investments now span the globe with greater urgency as it searches for new markets to tap into or existing economic partners in which it can strengthen its economic engagement. For the CCP, advancing China's economic growth is not only a driving force for its foreign policy, but is also a legitimizing force for the party itself within the country. Europe faces squarely in its aspiration and when it comes to its economic engagement abroad. The One Belt, One Road, as Marianne has already identified, seeks to further integrate economies of Europe and China, from the Netherlands to Germany and from Turkey to Greece. Beyond the infrastructure linkages that the One Belt, One Road seeks to create, Chinese investments in Europe have also been growing. According to the Mercator Institute for Chinese Studies, Chinese companies invested over 20 billion euros in the EU in 2015, which was a 44% jump from the year before. And this trend will continue. The greater economic ties between the EU and China have, however, raised concerns over EU member states' ability to present a united front vis-a-vis their China policy. A fracture between EU states was particularly noticeable after the 12 July Permanent Court of Arbitration decision over the South China Sea disputes, and the EU struggle to produce a swift and united agreement. In particular, it was said that Hungary, Croatia, and Greece were unwilling to criticize China directly in the statement. China's increasing investments in these countries was said to have played a direct role. This may certainly, to a certain extent, be true, and the report and an approach of remaining silent over concerns to international security for fear of economic retaliation is not one that serves the international community at large. However, it must also be remembered that Croatia and Slovenia had their own maritime delimitation dispute, which they at that time had agreed to settle via binding arbitration through the PCA. Following the PCA agreement over the South China Sea disputes, there was a notable concern that precedents in that decision had set that would impact, the dispute between Slovenia and Croatia directly. And Croatia subsequently released its own statement, noting that countries should settle disputes through direct negotiations instead. Nevertheless, the EU statement over the PCA ruling ultimately did not make a direct mention of China, and it was criticized as a weak response to Chinese intimidation and violation of international maritime law in the South China Sea. To some observers, China's economic diplomacy and leverage had worked. However, European states have awoken to the challenges that high levels of foreign investment can bring in Europe, and particularly so when opportunities for equal investment are not reciprocated. Earlier this month, the EU proposed a range of measures to address foreign takeovers by EU-based subsidiaries of a foreign firm, or foreign takeovers within the EU, or even to a certain extent, infiltration of management with individuals from non-EU countries. In particular, Germany, France, and Italy will be in focus, as will critical sectors such as defense, new technology, and transport. The proposal will also give the EU power to block takeovers by any company whose motivation is considered to be just for the purpose of disposing its overcapacity. China has, of course, featured most recently with regards to this, as Marianne has already stated, when it comes to anti-dumping, when it comes to steel. So while trade and investment between China and Europe is set to grow, careful management by both and an insistence on equal opportunities can help ensure that both parties stand to reap the economic benefits that lie ahead. In terms of China's foreign security policy, the EU plays a strong role through the EES. In the 2016 joint communique to the European Parliament and Council on elements for a new EU strategy on China, the EU noted that it should contribute actively to regional security in the Asia Pacific, but through diplomatic and economic means, while furthering partnerships in the region. As I've already noted and we've already heard so far, the EU seeks a fair economic engagement with China. However, any conception that the EU would seek a military role in the Asia Pacific is, I think, premature. Given the resources that the EU must commit to its direct neighboring regions due to instability that continues to be present and grow, the Asia Pacific is of less of a priority for, say, a coordinated EU patrol in the South China Sea, as was proposed by the French Defense Minister at last year's Shangri-La Dialogue. This does not mean, however, that what happens in the South and East China Seas are of no concern to the EU. Rather, it means that it prefers to use its diplomatic channels through engaging with regional actors in ASEAN as well as China. Indeed, the EU has continuously underscored why stability and security in the Asia Pacific is of direct concern. Any destabilization of vital maritime economic trade routes serves no one, and certainly not China and the EU. It has also underscored why it has every right to comment on the disputes. Not only is the EU a dialogue partner of ASEAN since 2012, with a dedicated ambassador to the organization, but it is also party to the region's Treaty of Amity and Cooperation in Southeast Asia. Any comment of unfairly meddling in the region's security is unfounded and should and has been rebuffed by the EU. The EU takes no position on the claims and consistently advocates for the disputes to be resolved through peaceful means, and that parties to the disputes should clarify their claims and pursue them in respect and accordance with international law, including UNCLOS. Beyond engaging with China through a comprehensive approach that ranges from the environment and human rights and trade, EU defense and security policy beyond non-traditional security cooperation will, to a large extent, however, fall on the shoulders of individual member states. From few European countries have this power projection capability to actively contribute to security in the Asia Pacific. France is one of them, as we've heard from Marianne, with a permanent presence through its territories in the Indian Ocean and South Pacific, and with strong bilateral and multilateral engagements throughout the region. Indeed, France, as we've heard, is currently dispatching one of its Mistral amphibious carriers to lead drills in the Western Pacific, along with the US and Japan. There's also speculation about whether the UK will play a stronger defense and security role in the region, but I will leave that to Bill to cover in the next topic. So what is the way forward? The EU is coming around to understanding what Chinese foreign policy means for its own prosperity and security. It is taking measures to ensure that European markets gain some form of protection and that the EU gains equal access to Chinese markets. However, as a normative power, the EU also has a duty to uphold international rule of law, whether it is in its immediate neighborhood or further afield. It should therefore lend greater support to international legal findings as well as to regional organizations like ASEAN. Looking ahead, the EU should also not be afraid, I think, to engage in Asia the way that China engages in Europe and elsewhere. Just as China has military exercises in the Mediterranean Sea with Russia, I think there is no reason why European states could not do so in Asia with countries in the region. This could be under the banner of the EU of sorts, and I think there is also a willingness for and an interest for European countries, not just states of the European Union, but in the region itself, to engage further in the Asia Pacific when it comes to security. For example, in last year's RIMPAC exercises, a record number of European states participated, even if this was only by contributing staff. Ultimately, Europe and China can shoulder the burden as global actors to uphold their responsibility to contribute to international security, based on norms and values that China itself prioritizes, namely mutual respect and a new international order in which we all participate around the world. Thank you.
Veerle, thank you very much indeed. I think that complemented Marianne's presentation very well, focusing much more on the EU dimension and some of the tensions the EU has in formulating a common policy, but the importance of them doing so. So I think that's a very useful follow-on. And for our third speaker, we have Bill Hayton, who will be known to a number of you as a very distinguished author on China's role in the South China Sea and a long-standing experience in the BBC and other media organizations. So Bill, over to you to bring it all together.
Right. Thank you very much. Whenever you mention the BBC, it means I then have to denounce my connection to the BBC for the purposes of this. The BBC has nothing to do with what I'm about to say, I have to say that. Marianne complained about being the first person after lunch. You try being the third person after lunch. I thought I'd begin with a little preamble. If you need a quick reality check about how quickly the world's changing and the need to adjust our traditional lens of thinking, have a look at this, published in the official journal of the Chinese State Oceanic Administration late last year. The title is Some Views on the Ocean Strategic Layout of the Atlantic Ocean for China. Okay? And the article goes on to say why China needs to build aircraft carriers and dominate the Atlantic Ocean in the same way that the US dominates other seas in the world. Anyway, we've already heard about the difficulties of getting consensus among members of the European Union for coherent action in support of the current status quo in East and South China Seas. So one particular example might demonstrate this. Anyone know the difference between these two ships? One's a destroyer and one is a frigate. Yep. But more importantly, the one on the left has an engine made in France and the one on the right has an engine made in Germany. So despite the EU's arms boycott on China, things obviously get through. As we've just heard twice, but I thought I'd show you a pretty picture, there are now British helicopters on board the Mistral. So there are various different ways of approaching security in the Asia Pacific. When they reach Tinian, there will be joint exercises with Japan and the United States. And what was clearly an off-the-record briefing to Reuters, Japanese sources trailed the whole thing as a show of force directed towards China, although that's not how any of the other governments will describe it, at least publicly. The fact that the UK is having to piggyback on the Marine Nationale to reach Asia tells its own story. Budgets are particularly tight, but necessity is the mother of invention, and combined defence planning between the two countries is becoming the norm. But even when the new British aircraft carriers are finally commissioned, it seems that at first they're going to embark US Marine Corps jets rather than British planes. And it would seem, though, that even with such creative thinking, it's the idea that the Queen Elizabeth, the HMS Queen Elizabeth, is going to make its first deployment to the South China Sea, as suggested by the British Embassy in Washington in December last year, is slightly over-optimistic. Nonetheless, interesting developments, I think, are afoot. Ambassador Darak's comments followed the well-publicised deployment of four RAF Typhoons plus refuelling and transport aircraft to East and Southeast Asia in October and November last year. Exercise Eastern Venture began with the participation in the annual five-power defence arrangements manoeuvres in Malaysia and Singapore, jointly with Australia and New Zealand. The planes then headed to Japan for 2 weeks for the first ever UK-Japan fighter exercise, Guardian North 16. And this, I'm told, is the first time ever that the Japanese Air Self-Defense Forces had hosted an exercise with a foreign military other than the US. Then on the way home, the Typhoon stopped in South Korea for Exercise Invincible Shield with Korean and US fighters. And I'm told that they then flew over the disputed reef at Scarborough Shoal to assert international rights to freedom of navigation. Unlike the US, however, I'm told the UK told all interested parties what they were about to do in advance. At the same time, the RAF soft power, the Red Arrows, was deployed to India, Vietnam, and China. So taken together, it was a creative means to demonstrate both diplomatic solidarity and engagement with Asia's most important powers. However, it's no secret that the whole exercise stretched the capacities of those involved almost to the limit. A less well-publicised first was taking place in North Wales at the same time. Here you see a Japanese self-defence soldier calling in an airstrike on the disused nuclear power station at Charlesfarnath in Snowdonia National Park. So there were five Japanese soldiers taking part in a military exercise, not only with the UK, but in possibly one of the oddest military coalitions ever assembled, the US, Malaysia, Ireland, and the United Arab Emirates, where they practiced a kind of NATO-like sort of Bosnia, post-Kosovo intervention. These are small developments, to be sure, but the fact that they happened at all, I think, is significant, as is the fact that the UK's last Strategic Defence and Security Review made specific mention of the five-power defence arrangements with of Commonwealth links with Australia and New Zealand, of Japan as a partner in the defence of the rules-based international order, of increased cooperation with Korea, and strengthened engagement with the 10 members of the Association of Southeast Asian Nations. These are all significant statements of intent. The recent announcement of a creation of a British defence staff in Singapore will help underpin this renewed interest in the Asia Pacific. Now, these stated commitments overlap in interesting ways with developments at NATO. Mainly as a result of the conflict in Afghanistan, NATO now has formal partnerships with four of the same countries, Australia, New Zealand, Japan, and South Korea. And in December, NATO hosted its first meeting with those Asia-Pacific partners at the Brussels headquarters. And I imagine that Alessio Patalano is going to talk a bit more about this in the next session. And what seems most significant about NATO's growing engagement with this part of the world is that it's clearly the result of requests from the region. While NATO has a stated commitment to nuclear non-proliferation, the reason it's focused on North Korea rather than other proliferators is, according to someone who should know, pressure from Japan and Korea. The same person also declares that there is no chance that NATO will be steaming through the South China Sea, but that some NATO members are keen to show that the same challenges the alliance faces in Europe, in terms of challenges to the international rules-based order, are also facing states in Asia with which European countries have close ties. Standing up for global principles may not necessarily be a military task for all those states, but the alliance structure can be a means of coordinating diplomatic stances where necessary. Asian states predominantly are looking to NATO for political support rather than military leadership. But it's revealing to compare Japan's diplomatic activism with the, with the torpor that characterizes Southeast Asian states' diplomacy. Six of the 10 ASEAN states have defense attachés based in London. Only one of them is here today. It's not clear what the rest do other than play golf with each other. In conversations, Southeast Asian diplomats in London don't seem to know what to ask for from the Europeans beyond vague declarations of political support. It seems hard to ascribe this to a reluctance to become entangled with the machinations of great powers. These are countries, after all, almost all of which are heavily engaged with the US military already, whether through carrot exercises or other forms of engagement. If they want to hedge and broaden their sources of support, why aren't they asking European states for help? The first step must be to ask, and then ask and ask again, just like Japan does. There's a chicken and egg problem here. Southeast Asian countries think that it's not worth asking, so they don't ask the European countries, so the European countries don't think there's any need for them to get involved, and the problem goes round and round. Of course, there are plenty of things for Europeans to worry about closer to home. This is a plot of Russian-related security incidents over the last 5 years in the European security space. And one of the current ironies is that while the US has been pushing Europeans to improve their abilities to defend their own backyard, the UK wants Japan to take on a bigger role in East Asia to allow the US to remain focused on Europe. So what else could Europe do in Asia? Only two European states, France and the UK, appear willing to expend, if not blood, then at least treasure in defense of the rules-based order in the Asia Pacific. What could the others contribute? Let's have a couple of ideas. Well, I've spent the last 5 years exploring the development of China's claims in the South China Sea, and the first thing to say about them is that they began here with the US Secretary of War, William Taft, asking the Chinese to investigate a Japanese occupation of a reef, Pratas Island, in 1907. The Chinese had no interest in the islands before 1909 or 1907. So the claim really emerged in response to domestic responses to international crises in 1909, 1928, 1933, and 1946. I can talk at great length, and I won't, but you can buy the book. The second thing to say is that despite their spurious origins, the Chinese historical narrative is what's driving China's actions. And the third point is that the logic of this claim is that China will not stop until it occupies every single feature within its U-shaped line in the South China Sea. Now, having said that, it's clear that some parts of the Chinese government are also making efforts to try to fit their claim into the rubric of international law. We've seen this in the wake of the arbitral tribunal ruling in July last year, with some modifications to Chinese behavior in the South China Sea and some official think tanks making the case for an UNCLOS-like basis for a modified claim. Now, the South China Sea is currently enjoying a period of relative quiet. There have been no major incidents since the oil rig clashes of June 2014 and only a few minor ones. At the same time, China's been rapidly consolidating its new artificial island bases. Now, there have been similar periods of quiet before. The question facing the region now is whether this is a new normal or merely the pause before the next round of activism. The experience of the past 40 years is that China has advanced in the South China Sea as its capabilities and the international situation have allowed, and only stopped when it has incurred costs. This is a PhD, former PhD by an Australian scholar, Andrew Chubb, and it basically shows the peaks and troughs in Chinese activity. Now, this is not Chinese activity. These are actions which were more assertive than the previous actions, i.e. further away from the mainland Chinese coast, or more extended, or more dramatic in some way. And you can clearly see a rise in the red, the level of coercive activities, and a general ramping up in terms of activities more widely, but also note the peaks and troughs that we have experienced in the past. If European governments are serious about contributing to the rules-based order in the Asia-Pacific, then diplomatic statements are not going to be enough. They will have to contribute to deterrence or something else. Given their lack of hard power in the region, European governments are, in effect, outsourcing deterrence to the United States. If it's to be credible, they're going to have to pledge political support to that deterrence, even if it's led by a Trump administration with which many have profound disagreements. They could also choose to develop creative means to impose costs on Beijing. They might decide, collectively or individually, that it's in the interest of the existing order to augment the capacities of the other claimant states to resist Chinese advances through the provisions of maritime awareness systems, maritime platforms, and even weapons. Europe could also work with the US and Japan to offer a grand bargain with Beijing, respect for the status quo in exchange for holding back on such support and other actions that may affect Chinese interests, such as the EU arms embargo. But, and this is one of my own, there is another option, one that might fit with Europe's self-image as a peace builder. The root cause of the instability in the South China Sea is the official Chinese territorial narrative. Now, this is a classic work of nationalistic fiction, akin to the kinds of arguments used to justify German territorial expansion in the 1930s. While there are many strategic arguments for China to want to control the South China Sea, not least as a bastion to hide ballistic missile submarines or to protect its trade routes, all these are underpinned by a sense of righteousness and entitlement generated by this warped historical narrative. I'll just give you a very quick example. So if you look on the Chinese Ministry of Foreign Affairs website, you'll see a reference to an ancient document which says that in the South China Sea, the water is shallowed and filled with rocks, and this proves that the Chinese, as far back as 220 AD, knew and understood and administered the South China Sea. However, if you actually go and translate this document into Chinese, you'll find it doesn't say that at all. It doesn't even mention the word South China Sea, and then it actually has a second sentence which says foreigners reinforce their big ships with sheet metal. So rather than actually backing up the Chinese claim, this actually undermines the Chinese claim. So, and there are many, 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 many other examples. Now, I think it's time to challenge this Chinese territorial narrative at source. And this would be much easier than most people think. There are many fine historians of the South China Sea in Europe, particularly in Germany, but also in the Netherlands, France, and the UK. Their research has already been published, but it's not widely known about or understood and hasn't reached China. It's time to bring this knowledge into the dialogue with Chinese officials and historians to show how sources have been distorted and misused in order to create the territorial claim. The purpose will be to undermine the sense of confidence and chauvinism that drives Chinese policy. It has the advantage of being both European and cheap. Thank you.
Well, Bill, thank you very much indeed. And you rose to the challenge of being the third speaker after lunch incredibly well by giving us a really entertaining slideshow. Lots of interesting material there, which no doubt on some specific issues we'll want to go away and digest, or indeed ask questions. So we have a few minutes left for Q&A. I may extend the session by 5 minutes or so, if that's okay, Peter. So if you'd like to indicate by raising your hands if you'd like to ask a question, and when you ask a question, please do tell me who you are. Now, the gentleman in the second row here got his hand up first, please.
Thank you.